Good. All right. We'll start with this one. So I'm going to withhold history just for a moment here. This is a relatively young person, and I think her primary symptoms were bothersome shortness of breath on exertion. And this is something that I think she's had for a while, but it's getting a little bit worse. So on the frontal projection, the lungs are overinflated. And let me show you some thin images from the CT. And here, as I scroll through it, pay particular attention. The findings are subtle to airways. So let me make this a little bit bigger. See if I can bring this out. And what I see on this is bronchial wall thickening, but also in places like this related to some airways like that, there are segments of segmental bronchi that contain material in their lumens. The airways are not dilated, but again, we can see it there and there. So let me just scroll down there and give you a feel for that. So again, look at it here, where you can see there is some abnormality related to generations of segmental bronchi, like that. See it there as well, but nothing else. The rest to me looks just fine. So because the symptoms were really quite severe apparently, and she does have obstructive airways disease on pulmonary function testing, which I'll show you in a moment, which is not really reversible with bronchodilator. The appearance was not that of just asthma. And in really to diagnose this, they proceeded to an open lung biopsy. So I will show you the result of the path, as well as, oh, I should tell you now that the patient has, and I didn't get this initially, I wish I had, maybe I would have picked up on it, a history of being a hairstylist for many years. Apparently she does this at her house, or she's some kind of business at home, but she's been a hairstylist for a long period of time. So let me bring this up here. And 23 years. Here you can see the pulmonary function tests. And I will show you the result of a lung biopsy that was done. Let me bring this up, and was also sent to some expert pathologists. And if you read that, you can see there is airway abnormality. There's some features of follicular bronchiolitis, the larger airways, presumably those bronchi associated with some goblet cell metaplasia, mucostasis, small airways are dilated, and maybe one vague non-necrotizing granuloma. So they were inclined to put that together with the history of prolonged exposure to hairspray, and there is the so-called entity of thesaurosis, which isn't, I don't think, used necessarily in the context of hairspray-related airway disease, but they think this may be a case of that. So this entity, I think, was initially described way back here in 1958, in which disease was attributed to hairspray. And on lung biopsy, some of these patients had granulomas, some had sarcoid-like granulomas. Sometimes when they took out the lymph nodes, there was granulomas there, but they've decided to probably to blame the patient's exposure to hairspray for these findings. So that is the clinical and pathologic diagnosis she has. I don't know if we've ever shown one here before at the webinar, or what was thought to be this entity.
So Howard, I have a case of a woman with who got HP from presumably from working as a hairdresser, and when she stopped and got steroids, got a lot better. I can try to remember to pull it for next week. But it's interesting. The ones I've seen had more fibrosis.
Yeah.
You wonder with some of the low molecular weight compounds in there that the HP might show up as well.
Exactly. Some of them pathologically in the biopsy when they're obtained, they have granulomas. So maybe they can look like HP.
Yeah.
But that's really interesting because I think these are definitely abnormal small airways, but not very abnormal, at least not imaging-wise.
Yeah, that's really interesting. What the heck is the derivation of the word thesaurosis? I mean,
I can't remember anymore. Let's see if that article describes that. I forget.
Yeah, I think the other interesting thing on her case too, Howard, is that there wasn't a lot of mosaic attenuation, which you would expect with constrictive bronchiolitis.
Nope.
I mean, there are a few areas that had decreased vessel caliber, but I mean, the lungs are pretty homogeneous.
They're pretty good, aren't they?
Interesting.
Yeah. So, of course, they've advised her to consider doing something about her occupation. I don't think that's gone over very well with the patient. I thought I might have had exploration imaging, but I do not, so perhaps this was done somewhere else. So, an interesting case of maybe that entity of thesaurosis. Okay, this next case is interesting. This is a patient with a history of transplantation. The transplantation was quite a long time ago, and fairly recently she came in with a set of symptoms, but the finding on chest radiography was a surprise. So let me bring that up. So the finding on chest radiography here in December compared to quite a long time ago is this nodular opacity. Quite large, quite circumscribed, right lower lung. And I will show you that on CT, in addition to that, she also has a couple smaller nodules in the lungs, which are new from before, so like that. And as we looked around, we saw a few more small nodules. Let me see if I can pick up another one like that. And there were another one in the right lower lung. Here is the larger one that we see on the chest radiograph. But there was a small nodule somewhere else, but I forget where that was. So let me show you the PET here. And you'll see on this that in addition to a very FDG avid dominant lesion in the right lower lobe, that we'll also see on the PET that these other smaller lesions are also FDG avid. And they're all over the place. So here is the large dominant lesion right there. So that's new from before. So it's not just that large nodular opacity in the right lower lung. She had a CT guided biopsy that initially showed or did not make a diagnosis, but that was repeated subsequently. And here you can see the biopsy right there going in. And here is the diagnosis. So this is PTLD. And if you look at the report, this is a PTLD, but also EBV positive, as you can see right there with the high proliferation index. Where did I see the EBV thing? Oh, right there. So kind of a delayed presentation of a PTLD about 6 years after transplantation. Kind of an interesting presentation. I didn't see any enlarged lymph nodes and there aren't any on the PET. So it's really nodular parenchymal disease. Most of the nodules being rather small, but this one being big and FDG positive. All right. Let me show one more case. I'm trying to remember what this one is. Oh, yeah. This is a cute case just from the other day. So let me bring up the frontal projection of the chest. And I'll bring up a previous for comparison alongside it. And that shouldn't happen. I don't know why that happens. So This is a patient, the history just said, I think, shortness of breath or a cough. And there's no abnormality related to the lungs or the pleura, but the findings relate to, actually, I first noticed it on the lateral projection. So let me bring that up right here. So I saw that first. There's small collections of gas right there, and there's one right there that correspond on the frontal projection to this right here and this right there. So she has breast implants. These are new findings and very consistent with just benign gas in relation to breast implants. So this person is in Park City, so there's some altitude involved, but the findings are very typical of this entity. This is the first one I've seen on chest radiography. I've seen a few, we've seen a few on CT, because usually the amount of air is really small. The amount of gas is really small. But this is the first time I've seen a little bit of peri-implant gas on chest radiography like that. So I thought that was just interesting, incidental finding. All right, Jeff.
All right.
Those are mine.
Howard, does the gas resolve when they go back to normal altitude?
I presume so. I don't really know.
Okay.
I think so. I think it might come and go. I don't really know. It's a strange phenomenon anyway.
All right. Travis, you ready now?
Sure. Yeah, I don't know if Jonathan ever had follow-up, because those patients just came to Denver to be referred and then left. So he probably never followed up to see if the gas was gone or not. We'll see. I'll start with this one. Yeah, and unfortunately, the most interesting case I deleted, and I'll have to save it for next week, but hopefully Seth will be here to see that one anyway. So this is a 48-year-old man who presented with a couple weeks of fever and chest pain, and when he finally presented, he underwent either an echo or a CT, and I don't know the sequence of events. It doesn't really matter. You see he's got a lot of mediastinal lymphadenopathy, and he has a pretty raging pericarditis, as you can see, that you can clearly see there's thickening of the visceral and then the fibrous pericardium. So it looks like it's an infectious pericarditis. He's got a small effusion as well, but then it gets interesting when you scroll down inferiorly and you see that there's this mass that's associated with his right atrium, and it has some calcification in it. It's not the best location for an angiosarc, just because those are usually in that right atrioventricular groove here, and sometimes thrombi will calcify, and certainly we've seen cases of, I know Jeff and others have shown cases of like fibrosing mediastinitis with involvement of the superior vena cava and things. So this was just kind of a perplexing mass here. He went on to have an MR, and I think the post-con nicely shows A, the thickening and enhancement of the pericardium, as well as this big enhancing mass here. So they took this out. He had no history of a primary tumor, because you think about metastatic disease. They took this out, and this turned out to be a synovial cell sarcoma of his pericardium primary, which is kind of interesting. I think that, you know, it's one of those sarcomas that whenever you see big and ugly tumors, oh, weird sarcomas always in the differential, like people have shown osteosarcomas of the heart and the pericardium, and you know, I don't think there's anything special about this cell type here, just that it's a primary sarcoma, slightly different than what we normally see. And then in the gross description, there were some comments on calcification and other things that was in there too. So unfortunately, he survived a couple of years, but ended up having recurrence and metastatic disease. And here you can see on the cine, just that large mass sitting right there. So another weird primary tumor to add to our list. This is a pretty interesting case, and I think it's one that shows the value of always reviewing the scout images as well, although in this case you'll see it's not that big of a dilemma. This is a patient that had a lung transplant for idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis several years prior to this, and the chronicity is hinted at by the fact that his clamshell sternotomy wires are fractured in many places. So this is when he came in on whenever this exam was, this first one. And you can see, you know, wire fragments and some of them along the lung as we see. And then there's one that's kind of teasing the pericardium right here. And this was an old exam, so it was just a step and shoot acquisition. And then 2 months later, he came back, and here's the exam 2 months later, and you'll see that in that short period of time, that there's now something that has migrated into, completely into the pericardium. And it happens to be one of these wire fragments. And you can see there's a little bit of pericardial fluid, and maybe there's a little bit of inflammation here at this time as well. And you can actually see what's weird is though, although you barely see the tip of this wire in here, there was actually more, some sort of fluid, presumably a little hematoma or something in the pericardial space. But I think it's a good example of where you just look at the scout image, and you can see how in the course of 2 months, this thing migrated like that to right here. And then of course they followed it up a couple weeks later with a contrast enhanced study, and it had migrated even more inferiorly and was kind of wrapping around the right atrium here, but sitting within the pericardial space. And they were able to go in and remove this without much difficulty. They didn't have to go into the heart. It did not, fortunately, it had not punctured the heart. So, but this is the first time I've seen the sternal wire migrate into the pleural space. I know we've shown other sternal wire misadventures. I remember, Howard, you showed that case where they had sutured the sternal wire into the ascending aorta. But this was one that just over time, this is the worst complication of a fractured one I've seen.
Travis, I don't know if I showed it. It would have been a long time ago. But we had one that migrated into the right ventricle. It's still there. We actually saw the patient in follow-up a couple weeks ago or so.
Really?
Yeah, it's a, I think it's a lunger heart transplant, and they just left it.
Yeah. What was the time course that it over which it migrated? Because this one, you know, went pretty quickly from when it got access to the pericardium and moved in, because this patient was having serial CTs every few months.
No, lung transplant. Ours was just on radiographs, and it was over like a year that, you know, they came to clinic for their annual visit or something.
Yeah.
Cool. Guys, I showed a case of a sternotomy wire in lung transplant a few weeks ago that had migrated into right atrium and then embolized to a pulmonary artery. So those things do move around.
Yeah. But yeah, and also I think it's just a reminder, always look at the scout, how obvious it is. Not that you wouldn't see that on the images going into the pericardium as well, but certainly more interesting there. This is a quick one. This is one of those ones that was, you know, I show it because we have path proof. This is one of those things that usually doesn't need path proof, but this is a patient who's 75, had a shoulder injury elsewhere, ended up with a shoulder radiographs, a shoulder MR, that identified a left-sided pleural abnormality, prompted a CT referral to our CT surgery service, you know, with a presumptive diagnosis of a fibrous tumor of the pleura. And so he shows up on the day when we're doing biopsies, you know, a week ago. And instantly you can see, you know, yes, we've seen probably occasional very small fibrous tumor. Not crazy about it for that look for a couple of reasons. One, it's situated right in the intercostal space. And number two, if you see when you put a region of interest on it, and this came up in discussion when I showed that big posterior mediastinal ganglioneuroma a few weeks ago, that you have this, you can see that the mean attenuation is 10 Hounsfield units. So this thing has some low attenuation elements in it. It's a little bilobed, and I don't know if it's under remodeling the undersurface of this rib or not. But, you know, it's one of those ones where we could have probably done an MR and confirmed the diagnosis. We were thinking this was going to be a nerve sheath tumor, but I think the patient was so anxious because he had been given this presumptive diagnosis of a tumor somewhere else. We went ahead and did a biopsy, and you can see we just did a CT guide biopsy, and I do have the report here. Let me pull it open and show you. Yeah, and not surprisingly, this came back as a schwannoma. So I think, like I said, we don't usually biopsies. I don't know if you guys have biopsies of these as well, but it's one of those issues where when they get referred in, they have this idea that they have a potentially malignant tumor in them, you know, somewhere else, that they're reassured when we get tissue on something like this. Are you used to seeing, one question I have though, are you guys used to seeing them a little bit more bilobed than this? Because I always think of them much more just uniform and oval shaped, but I know that when we've shown cases of neurofibromatosis, some of the longer ones get a little bit more multilobulated. But is there anything that would raise an alarm for any of you with this look?
No, I don't think so.
Yeah. So, but this is a path proven case now of a schwannoma. So, all right. Well, one more quickie, and this is just because I was putting together an upcoming pericardium talk, and this is a case from a few years ago that I found, and it's one that we show on occasion, but I think this is a nice example. This is a lady who had a near syncopal event, and so that prompted an echo, and the echocardiography, the transthoracic echocardiography, commented on they're having trouble seeing the posterior wall of her left ventricle, and so that prompted further evaluation. I don't know at what point in time. I think this radiograph was actually done years before the event where she came in, but you can see she's got a little bit of a weird left heart contour here. And then when you look on the lateral view, you can see that, you know, the posterior wall of her left atrium and left ventricle certainly looks more well-defined than we normally see. And I think also, you know, we're used to seeing the left pulmonary artery. You see a little bit more lucency between it and the aorta than you normally do. Of course, you probably know or suspecting what this is when you look at the CT that was done, and you just see that her heart's kind of fallen into her left hemithorax, her left ventricle maybe, you know, a little on the big side. But when you look around here, you see that she has some portions of her right portion of her pericardium, but nothing really on the left. And I think one of the telltale signs is when you see where you should have that pericardial fluid, the little bikini bottom sign that you get with fluid. Instead, you just see lung herniating in there without any pericardium around there. So, of course, this is a case of complete absence of her left pericardium. And so we usually think of it as right versus left, and it's the idea is it's some sort of regression or obliteration of the common cardinal vein or something during in utero, and clearly she has been asymptomatic for this for 75 years. But I thought this is a good example just showing the typical look here where you see the lung herniating into areas where you would normally see pericardial fluid, even here where you might expect to see a portion of the transverse sinus and the oblique sinus.
Yep.
So, yeah, and I don't know if you guys have any, Howard or David or Jeff, if you guys have any comments on the radiograph too, because I remember there are a lot of different signs you can see with this, I don't remember them in particular right now, but those were some of the things that were jumping out at me, like here. You can see the intermediate stem line, which obviously is on the right. It just looks more lucent even in the inferior, you know, hilar region than it should, but.
No, that one is really subtle. It's more the shape of the heart, the way the heart, thermal projection, when you're primed to think of it, that it has a fairly distinctive appearance. And sometimes that main pulmonary artery segment, a little mobile there, may tip one off, but it's mostly the appearance of the heart and the
apex. Yeah, it's just kind of falling over to the side there.
Yeah, it's a fairly distinct appearance.
Okay, well, those are my cases for this week.
All righty. David?
I've got a couple. So a few weeks ago, I showed a case of a upside down intra-aortic balloon that had been inserted from a left subclavian artery. And the problem was that the thing was migrating upward, which is, you know, normally when these things pull out, you know, would move downward. But if it's put in from above, then as it pulls out, it moves upward. And it was getting into left subclavian artery, and so you don't want this balloon of this big caliber balloon to blow up in a subclavian artery. So here's a person who had an intra-aortic balloon. At this point, the tip is below the aortic arch as we would like, and on subsequent radiographs, they may have replaced a that first one I showed you might have been put in from the groin because it looked as if we were seeing the faint part of the tip higher. But this one now there's an axillary approach. So clearly there's an axillary catheter at this point. I'm not sure whether there was on that previous image. And notice that the tip is higher now. It's in the aortic arch. And as we move on, this tip keeps moving more high. And at this point, it's now well into the arch. So it's beyond this distal part of the arch. It seems to be tracking back. Here is the insertion here from the right axilla. And things got even grosser here, and people were not responding to phone calls about this. Here it is moving toward the arch, moving above the arch. And at this point, it's gone way up into the brachiocephalic artery. So that means that we have this huge expansive balloon that's blowing up not only in the aortic arch and endangering carotid arteries and subclavian arteries with trauma, but also the right brachiocephalic artery, which is a much smaller vessel, is getting this full caliber balloon blown up in it. And here's this morning's radiograph that actually shows air in the balloon, or not air, but helium in the balloon. So the balloon's inflated at this point, and you can see that the lucency goes through the aortic arch and into the brachiocephalic. At this point, they pulled it back or pushed it in somewhat so that it was a little bit lower in the brachiocephalic artery, but still we've got all this gas here in the aortic arch heading out into brachiocephalic artery. So this is not a good result. You don't want the trauma of this balloon inflation affecting the aortic arch, endangering carotid arteries, subclavian arteries, and small vessels like subclavians, or in this case, brachiocephalic artery. So that's one of the problems, I think, with this axillary approach or subclavian approach to these things, is that they tend to pull back, and that means that they endanger these branch vessels. So I hope somebody will take care of that. So we had some discussions about that with cardiology this morning. So here's a person, this is following up on Jeff's case of a squamous cancer with cavitation. This was a recent case that his case last week reminded me of, so I pulled this. This woman has a transitional cell cancer of the bladder, and it is metastatic to lung, and we have these, in some cases, thin-walled cavities, cavitary metastases with some fluid levels in them and some solid or solid lesions down here. So if we back up in her course, this is the beginning of 2017. At this point, she had a few solid metastases, and one of the bigger ones is down here, sort of paraspinal. And then things progressed, and here's a more recent CT scan showing now this cavitation here, and we're approaching thin walls. There's some surrounding consolidation up here. I don't know whether that's blood or infection around these upper lobe cavities. Sort of nasty looking thick walls surrounding stuff. Again, I think they might be hemorrhaging or something like that, causing this ground glass around them. And then a large lesion here with a fairly low attenuation center, and this paraspinal lesion, much bigger than it was a year before, has low attenuation in it. This one has a fluid level in it. So transitional cells are a kind of squamous cell. The cells on the surface of a transitional epithelium, say in the bladder, are actually squamous in shape, and they have a lot of keratin in them, and they, you know, squamous cells are designed to slough off. So your skin is always sloughing. That's what dogs follow when they're trailing your scent, is they're it's your shed skin cells that they're sniffing out. So we're shedding cells all the time. Squamous cells are designed to be shed, and I think they accumulate then in the center of the lesion. They liquefy, the keratin gets degraded, liquefied, it gets coughed out, and that's how these things arrive, I think, at their cavitary status with their thin-walled cavities. I've seen several cases of bladder cancer undergo this, and if you treat these people with chemotherapy, you can sometimes precipitate the cavitation. So I think you kill the cells, they die, they've sloughed into the center of this lesion, they liquefy and get expelled. And that's how you end up with thin-walled cavities. So transitional cell cancers undergo that same sort of thing that other kinds of squamous cancers do. Okay. Mm-hmm. And right. then I want to show you this old example here of the ATRA syndrome, which is, so ATRA is, I think it stands for all trans-retinoic acid. It's a therapy that's used for acne, and it's can be used for APL, so promyelocytic leukemia. What happens, this ATRA is kind of a vitamin D analog. It forces these cells to mature and be expelled from the marrow. So it will when you administer this lesion to treat APL, you cause this proliferation and expulsion of large numbers of these promyelocytes. It forces them to mature into mature myelocytes and be released from the marrow into the bloodstream. And then I think you get sludging and things like that. So you get what's called the Atrus syndrome, now called the differentiation syndrome. And this can result in a lot of capillary leak, lung edema, and pleural effusion. So this is what the person looked like going into this treatment here with some basal atelectasis. And a few days later, lungs are still clear. And then things start to cloud up. And within a few days, this diffuse lung disease, this edema, the accompanying pleural effusions, I don't have lateral views, was beginning to clear. You can see at this point, things are getting better. At this point, there's no visible pleural effusion. And then a couple of weeks later, I'm sorry, we're a couple of weeks later here, no, 522, a few days later, we're back to our ordinary basal atelectasis. So this is a cause of, can be rapid onset of lung edema, shortness of breath. They can have, I think, anasarca accompanying this and pleural effusions. And then it dries up fairly quickly. So Atrus syndrome. We had a recent, we had a case 2 weeks ago, or a case last week of this same syndrome, but this older example from 2001, I think was more dramatic and had better imaging. Okay.
All right.
Those are my cases. Yeah.
Thank you. All right. Let's see. So this is, I got a couple of artifacts here. So this is a fun little artifact that, so this patient had a, I think it was an endometrial cancer, and this was a MET screen, and there was nothing exciting to look at, but had a PET done just before, so this was, I don't know if it's part of a research study where they got a combined PET and then a regular CT instead of just the attenuation correction, but you can see there's this area here of FDG uptake, so went back and looked at the CT again, tried to see if there's something in the liver or the bone, you know, some kind of misregistration, but that is not the case. So I don't know if you guys have seen this before, but the this is what they call a hot clot. It's where when they're injecting the FDG and they're getting venous access and they pull back a little bit, sometimes they get some clotted blood and it gets labeled with FDG and then it embolizes into the pulmonary artery. So, and it's extremely intense uptake, very high SUV, but there's no correlate on the CT, on the regular CT scan here. So we come down here and you just see there's absolutely nothing in that area. And just one of the artifacts to be aware of. And then this is an interesting case we had. This is a patient who has a Hürthle cell thyroid cancer. This is an I-131 scan, and we see a physiologic uptake in the salivary glands, and there's in the bowel, but you also notice there's uptake in the lungs, particularly in the right upper lobe. So we did a CT scan to take a look at what's going on, and you can see there's debris in the airways. There's small airway-centered nodules. In that right upper lobe, tree and bud, if you like, some mild bronchiectasis. And then we have some similar findings in the anterior upper lobe, a few in the middle lobe, and elsewhere. So a good look for some sort of infectious bronchiolitis, you know, maybe a non-tuberculous mycobacterial infection would be good, potentially aspiration, although I like, there is debris in here, and she has had treatment to the neck, but I like it for mycobacterial disease. So we did find this paper as soon as it loads up here that looked at false positive uptake of radioiodine, and you know they go through the whole mechanisms of it, the physiology, but there's a nice list of places where you can see it, and you can see you know you'll see it in thymus, esophagus, and then further down they have examples in the lung right here. So inflammation. So there's increased perfusion and vasodilation, enhanced capillary permeability, including acute respiratory infection, bronchiectasis. If it's aspergillus, I suspect you can also see it in chronic, you know, or TB, you can see it in MAC as well. So I think this explains it. We didn't see anything that looked like a metastasis related to this uptake. So just another one of these nuclear medicine type of things that can be a pitfall. All right. Here's a little companion case to go with Travis's case. Luckily, this one is a better case. So this is a patient who had this mass, I think he's a 57-year-old man, protruding into the right atrium. It's fat attenuation, but there was questionable little bit of perfusion or calcium in it, and you can see it's kind of pushing the cava. Looks like it's probably arising from the wall of the inferior vena cava and growing up into the atrium. So patient had cardiac MR, which, if I can get all the right sequences here, let's see. So they did pre and post different sequences, and it follows fat on all those different sequences. This is the post-GAD, and you can see there's no enhancement. And what's really kind of cool is the, I think I got them. I thought I had them. I had the flow images that showed it. Okay, here we go. So these are the fat fraction. You can see very much fat. And then if we have pulled the water fraction, you can see very low. So this is a lipoma. I thought I had the flow images that showed all the blood going up into the aorta, to the azygos vein. They may be buried somewhere, but I can't seem to find them right now. So this is just a big lipoma. You see it's on T2, you can see it's fat. It follows fat on all the sequences. So I'm not seeing a lipoma grow there.
Oh, and sometimes we see just compression of the IVC from fat that doesn't look that well encapsulated.
Right.
Yeah, that's a really interesting one. Yep. They didn't take it out, did they?
No. I think they're going to leave it there unless he's having symptoms from it. I mean, I guess it could be a nidus for clot, but.
Well, I just wonder if some of it's brown fat and it could just be lipomatous hypertrophy just in an unusual place.
It would be hard to take it out too because of the involvement. So this is a trauma case. This is like a motor vehicle crash. And, this is something that we've seen a fair amount recently. And I don't know if we just didn't appreciate them a while ago, like years ago, or we're seeing them because things are changing in car safety. But this is another case. This was a motor vehicle crash where right at the bottom of our chest scan, we're seeing this thickening of the crus. So it's the anti-Godwin sign. Instead of thinning of the crus, we're seeing thickening of it. And these are often associated with upper abdominal trauma and stuff, or lower rib fractures. But I've seen a handful probably in the last year, three or four, of these diaphragmatic, intra-diaphragmatic hematomas, where you get this mark thickening right at the crus associated with other injuries often. And I wonder if it has to do with seat belts and airbags and some sort of just different stability, some of these pretensioners they have. But I just remember as a resident not really seeing these at all. We would see fractures and we would see the hemothorax, but I can't remember much about that at that time. But very important place to look, and it's often at the bottom of the chest or the top of the abdomen is where you're going to pick these up. But the ones I've seen have been associated either with lower rib fracture, splenic injury, liver injury. Kind of makes sense. So it's sort of right where that lap belt would be if it was a little too high in the waist.
And you've seen several, Jeff?
I'm sorry?
You've seen a couple?
I've seen at least three or four of them probably in the last 12 months.
Should write them up? I don't think I've seen that before.
Yeah, we'll have to look at them. And they don't do anything about them because they're contained and they just heal on their own. It would be interesting to see what happens to them 6 months later. Does it undermine the diaphragm? Is there a hernia develop? I don't know the answer to that. But yeah, she was just, most of her trauma was down low with a little bit of gas in there. So,
but Jeff, do we know what sort of trauma she had in the car? Was she
high-speed motor vehicle crash?
She ran into something or something? This wasn't
We don't often know. Often we just get motor vehicle crash.
Right.
I don't know why we got the inverted. That's because of the acquisition, but here we can probably see it out. So that's let's go to the other side here. one of the chrome. Never mind. I won't do the reformats. But yeah, I'll have to get my other ones out and put them out. All right. Oh, this one, David, you'll like because we were talking about strep last week. This is just impressive. So this is a 34-year-old woman. She does have a history of Crohn's disease. Can't remember if she was on azathioprine, and had a history of alcohol and some other things, and presented to our emergency department with cough and fever. And you can see she's got this cavitary mass-like area of consolidation on the right upper lobe. She's got some debris inferiorly, nice bulging fissure. Whoops, I don't want to show you all that yet, why it's doing that. So, you know, diagnosed her with infection. They opted for a CT scan, which they really didn't need. It showed the area of consolidation, cavitation, and the stuff below. So doesn't really help. You know, you'd wonder if she was an aspirator, given her history of alcohol abuse, a lot of debris in there. And then this was some sort of, you know, polymicrobial or anaerobic infection. But she got sick really, really fast and ended up in the ICU for quite a while. And developed purpura fulminans, so sort of like a septic shock type picture. And you can see these skin areas of redness, blistering on her fingertips, these patches. I'll spare you the rest of them. But you can see this ended up growing out. They actually cultured Streptococcus pyogenes from her blood. So that's what causes strep throat. That's that type A strep or group A strep, which is a really, pus-forming, aggressive streptococcal group of organisms and has been implicated in sepsis and these other things like staph. But since David had shown that case of the other strep case, I thought I would show this one. And it can move really fast. And this is a young person. We know she was somewhat immune compromised for a couple of reasons. But, you know, we've just this week, we've seen some young people with respiratory infections end up in the ICU.
So, Jeff, yes. You think this was strep pneumonia then? Do you think this was the primary site that seeded the blood?
Yeah, I think she started in her lungs, which is, it's not a common cause of infectious pneumonia in the lung. I mean, it's just, it's been described, but it's just not very common. So I don't know if, you know, as far as I know, she did not have a head and neck involvement, but there are, you know, a percentage of the population is colonized with group A strep. They're the carriers that reinfect everybody in their house when you get an outbreak. And it's possible she's a carrier. She could have aspirated some of it and just happened to set up shop and cause an infection. Because it's not a common cause of community-acquired infectious pneumonia. So
Jeff, we have a case of pneumonia that looks just like this with cavitation right upper lobe like this, fluid level and everything like that. And it was also strep, but I'll have to go back and get the species.
Okay.
It was about 3 weeks ago. It was really a nasty pneumonia. So don't underestimate strep. It's horrible.
Yeah. All right. And then one last one for fun. And this is an old case, but who knows? I may have even shown it in the past, but I lose track after so many years. So this was just a nice congenital case of congenitally corrected L transposition of the arteries. But it's more interesting because it's one of the complications of it. So we've got the pulmonary artery and the aorta are switched, and the aorta is off to the left and anterior, so it's an L transposition. But we also have atrioventricular discordance. So this is a morphologic right ventricle. There's a moderator band. The inflow and outflow are separated somewhat, so there's not a common sort of skeleton between the AV valve and the arterial valve. So this is why it's congenitally corrected. So blood goes to all the right places. The problem is, of course, this ventricle is not configured to pump to systemic circulation for long periods of time. Well, this was an older patient. She also has other findings. She's got duplicated superior vena cavae. She's left dominant, so there's no azygous vein, but there's a large hemiazygous vein, which you can see retrograde flow of blood down. But her main problem is her left bronchus. Is she's developed, because of this large pulmonary artery being where it's not supposed to be, and just the previous surgeries and stuff, she does have a malacia of her airways. You can see this left bronchus. And this is during inspiration, but it's thickened. The cartilage doesn't look as healthy. And they end up putting a stent in here to protect this lung. But you can see even there's a little bit of heterogeneity in the lungs. Some of it may be perfusion related, but I suspect a lot of it is due to gas trapping as well. So they also, most of these patients have arrhythmias. And then the other cool finding is for coronary anatomy. You can see the, so this is the morphologic right coronary artery, and it comes off where it's supposed to. The, what is, I guess you would call the morphologic left anterior descending, so the anterior interventricular coronary artery comes off, looks like from the same origin or very close to the interventricular one here, and it passes between the rotated aorta and pulmonary artery and kind of squeezes right between the two of them and then heads on out too. So lots of interesting congenital anomalies, but I don't know if I've seen the coronary one associated with this. I don't know, Travis, if you've encountered it. Usually they just, everything's just flipped to the normal, the opposite location.
Yeah, they're frequently other anomalies too, like that. So I think that, you know, it's not surprising.
Yeah.
And her tricuspid valve was okay. She didn't have that left Epstein's anomaly that can accompany this.
No, it looks like this would be the tricuspid valve, and it looks like it's okay. Yeah, she'd been seen here a long time. I was just looking at her airway anatomy too. She has a she has normal airway situs, but the left upper lobe bronchus is, it's just being kind of pushed down here. So yeah, we saw her the other day just for stent follow up. So she just has this bronchomalacia and a stent there.
Wow.
Yep. Okay, well, that's what I have. Anything else?
Anyway? Great.
All right. Well, thanks, guys, and we will meet again next.
I can show one more. Just take a few moments. We've seen this before, but I just remembered I have a nice example of a – let me see what's happening here. Do you see my screen? Yep.
Yes.
We see your OSIRIX database window.
Let's see if I'm frozen or not here. Hold on a second. Well, let me just quick start again. So this is the evolution of a lung adenocarcinoma. And let me bring up the thins that we have more recently. And we have, for the previous one, we don't have thins. We just have fives. So on the left, we have, actually, these are not separated much in time, are they? Let me just see something. Sorry, this is what I want to bring up. So the time interval here is from April of 2016 and September of 2017. Make sure I've got the right case. So here is the lesion, and I think we would all be comfortable calling this a GGO. It seems to be a pure GGO, or very close to a pure GGO lesion, and we'd certainly follow that up. We could use Fleischner 2 that deals with the GGOs or the part solids. So I'm not quite sure what was done over that period of time, but going forward in time, it now has clearly, I'll make this bigger, it clearly has solid elements within. So let me just scroll through that, and you can see instead of being a pure GGO, there are a couple places where there are small, irregularly shaped, internal, more solid components. So that change alone is certainly concerning for the development of an adenocarcinoma within. And this is an adenocarcinoma. It turned out to have mostly lipidic growth, but there is an adenocarcinoma which is relatively small, no visceral or no bronchovascular invasion. There is some invasion of stroma, but the development of a pretty typical small invasive adenocarcinoma. and the nice demonstration of the evolution of a part solid lesion from a GGO. It's bigger overall, but the solid component is clearly concerning. So a nice demonstration of that phenomenon.
Howard, I think just a point to the learners who watch this, that the Fleischner paper also makes the point that you can't characterize these nodules appropriately without thin section CT. So, because you can get fooled, miss the, like, you know, who knows if those solid components were there or not. It's hard to say.
Smaller, exactly. It is hard. It is hard when you just have fives to really figure that out when you're dealing with something like this. It's hard.
Yep. I kind of wonder on that last slice if there's a couple little solid things right in there, or if there's part of that. Yeah, it's hard. That's why, hard to tell. Nice.
Yep, it is hard. Yeah, right. Definitely hard to tell. You know, alrighty, very good.
Yeah. Speaking of adenocarcinomas, we got the path on one that we found on a screen, and you guys remember I sent that one around years ago. That was it had like a very thin solid rim and a very cystic center, and how you know, we got what people would call it with lung rads, ended up being a cancer. Well, this was another similar one. It was predominantly cystic with a little bit of rim of ground glass, and it was scored as a 4X and came back as an adenocarcinoma with micropapillary, which is a poor prognosis. It was actually a grade 2. I mean, it was poorly differentiated. So it wasn't one of these indolent ones. It was actually one that had potential to become very aggressive quickly. I'll try to remember to bring it next week as well, because it's one of the types of lung cancers that we all recognize that lung rads still does not address. How do you score these cystic ones, which we know has a high rate of being adenocarcinoma? And the question always is because that'll impact whether you watch it or you act on it. And this one, by the time it was diagnosed and everything, was a T2A high-grade cancer. So it's not an early stage one that we're trying to find. So I'll bring it next week and show.
Yeah, we've seen a few of these micropapillaries too, and they can be in small nodules, just like the one that Howard showed. And it's scary because they really do oftentimes come back with a vengeance.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thanks, everybody. And we will see you next week.
Thank you.